Well, first of all, did you know that you were going to be an alternate in this case?
No, I did not.
Were you disappointed when you found out?
I was. After, 3 weeks of my time and getting invested and all kinds, emotional and all over the place, when he turned and said, "Number 96, you're an alternate," yeah, my heart broke a little bit.
Yeah.
But.
I was gonna, and what I was gonna mention about that, the Knorr case, I forgot to finish my thought. There was a lady, and she looked just like you, actually, similar age, and she took more notes than anyone else. She was just always buried like this, and I knew that she was going to be the alternate. And then at the very end, when the judge said, "Put down your notebooks and you're done," her face just went.
Yeah. That was a feeling like, all the air just went out of you.
Yeah. Well, when you made it on the jury, how much did you know about the case, and what were your thoughts on being a part of it?
What I knew about the case was I saw the video, not in its entirety, but I saw it 2 to 3 times on the news, so just various clips on the news. I don't use social media. I know that's odd, but I don't. So I didn't post anything or see anything on there.
So you're kind of the perfect juror then, coming in with about as clean of a slate as somebody could have when you consider how big of a case this was.
Yeah, I mean, I do. I did tell them I did see the settlement run across the bottom of a screen one day.
Yeah.
So
What did that mean to you when you saw it?
I knew it was a separate case. I knew civil is different with different rules, and it didn't affect me. So I wasn't surprised there was a settlement. I was surprised they announced it beforehand, but that was about it.
Did you want to be a juror?
I had mixed feelings. There was a question on the questionnaire about that, and I put I didn't know. Because the reason at that time was obviously I didn't know what the outcome was going to be. So I felt like either way the outcome was, or you're going to disappoint one group or the other. So I didn't want to go through this whole rioting and destruction again, and a little concerned about people outside my house if they weren't happy with the verdict.
Right.
So
What were your thoughts on the fact it was televised?
it made it more intense, I think. At least I thought that at the beginning, but I'm glad it was eventually. So it's transparent and everybody knows and can't question what happened. It's all right there for you. So.
So you were an alternate, would you have voted guilty or not guilty?
I would have said guilty. With that said, however, at the end, the judge did read us the rules for deliberation, but it was pretty quick to me. I mean, I didn't absorb everything. So I would have said guilty on some level. After I was excused, I did not look at the jury instructions any longer. So I don't know if.
Yeah, you don't know how hard that process was.
Right. But I feel like he's responsible.
Why?
So I just think the prosecution did a really good presentation of their case. Dr. Tobin was the one that I really related to. And I feel like all the doctors, in one way or another, all pretty much said the same thing. So I feel like they backed each other up. So.
Do you think the use of force was reasonable?
I don't know.
Do you think that Derek Chauvin caused George Floyd's death?
I feel like the kneeling on the neck for so long did, yes.
When it came to those arguments on those two topics, that seemed to be, I mean, did you feel like you heard a lot about, use of force, was it reasonable, and did the knee cause the death? Did it seem like those were two of the major questions that were presented to you?
Yeah, like the use of force. Was it excessive? Was it necessary? When do we stop it? Could have been stopped at one point and something else happened, because I kept thinking that critical decision-making model. It was in the back of my mind, and how they said you have to reassess and reassess constantly, look around, and I felt like that wasn't being done.
Who was it that did it for you on the use of force?
As far as
Like, which witness convinced you that it was unreasonable use of force?
it was on the prosecution side. I thought Jody's the
Stecker.
expert, yeah. He did a really good job of explaining it to us, I feel. So.
Was it meaningful to you to have Minneapolis police officers get up there and testify against Chauvin?
It was. Some of the trainers, you know, said that, I don't even know what that is. We do, you know, meaning we don't train like that. I've never seen that before. So that was helpful to hear. Because I know that they said they can use of force. It just didn't seem like they could use that type of force.
Right.
Yeah.
When it came to the medical stuff, you mentioned Dr. Chauvin. What was it about him that was so impactful on you?
He broke it down to where we could understand it. You know, obviously he's very educated. But he made it to where we could understand it. And he actually had us demonstrate. We were all in the jury and we all were touching our necks, the front of our necks, the back of our necks, as he was saying, and we could feel what he was trying to make us feel. So that was interesting. And then I guess what really did it was when he said, right here at this point is where he had that seizure, and this is where he died. So that's exactly what it was for me.
Yeah.
So.
Up to that point, was that a turning point for you in the trial?
It was. I did consider the defense, you know, the heart condition or the enlarged heart, narrowing of the arteries, the drug use. But regardless of all that, I don't think he would have passed away that day on that particular time. Mm-hmm. You know.
Was there ever any moments where it tipped toward the defense for you?
Like the first or second day. I feel like Mr. Nelson did a really good job. He was believable. He did bring out a lot of good points. And I guess when he said, we're just concentrating on that 9 minutes and 29 seconds and nobody's really talking about the 16 minutes prior, was kind of an eye-opener for me. So I did listen to what he said, and I did think all the officers were reasonable, a reasonable officer in that first 16 minutes. But then, for whatever reason, once Mr. Floyd was put in on that prone position on the ground, all that seemed just to go out the window.
Right.
It didn't apply any longer, in my point of view.
What was the key evidence, in your opinion?
You know, just all the testimony by the experts, the forensics, you know, they did a good job too. And honestly, it was all the perspectives from the different videos. I think it would be harder to understand exactly what happened, but the videos is what really nailed it.
Which video in particular stuck with you?
The bystanders. Miss Frazier's video. So I think she was very brave of her to tape it and post it.
Did her testimony impact you as well?
It did. I was sitting closest to the door in the back row that we entered, so I was pretty close to the witness stand. And I know they were testifying, but I feel like I could actually feel it. It broke my heart when she said that she apologized to Mr. Floyd, and she wished she could have did more to save her life. That's a lot for a 17-year-old to go through.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So, I think us at home, we were all thinking the same thing at that moment.
Yeah.
Were you left with any lingering questions, like, why didn't we get an answer on this, or why didn't somebody talk about this?
Just at the very end, when I guess nobody really thought about the carbon monoxide issue, I was kind of wondering why that was thrown in there at the last minute. So I didn't know why they didn't bring that up sooner if they were going to talk about it. Mm-hmm. And then nobody could say if the car was on or off, the squad car. Mm-hmm. You know, nobody could verify that, so.
What was your impression of Eric Nelson?
I think he did a really good job. I think he had a lot to do. I feel like it was him and the lady that was helping him. And then you look over at the prosecution team, and they got four lawyers sitting over there, and all their volunteers and aides. So they had a really big crew compared to Mr. Nelson. Mm-hmm. So I think he was credible. I think he made a lot of valid, good points.
What was your impression of Steve Slisher, the prosecutor?
Relatable. I think he took his time and presented stuff well and wasn't trying to make us believe something, but rather bring it out and say, hey, you know, you might want to think about this or this is what happened. Yeah.
And how about Jerry Blackwell?
I thought he was very good. We kind of made a comment about Johnny Cochran Jr. there in our jury room.
Right.
So, yeah.
And then what about Judge Cahill?
Very fair. Very fair. Very impressed with him. Like I said, when we were dismissed 96 and 118, he asked us to come into his judge's chambers. And it was just pure courtesy on his part. He didn't have to do that. I very much appreciate him reaching out to us. And I feel like he showed concern if we were okay, how they did, could they did stuff better. So very appreciative of that.
What was your impression of Derek Chauvin?
So where I was sitting, the times I wasn't taking the notes and I would actually look up, I did lock eyes with him a few times. So kind of made me feel a little uncomfortable, you know, by looking at each other. I mean, he has nowhere to look either. He looks up and I'm the first person he can see. It was just kind of weird. You know, I don't think he was trying to make any gestures or anything by that at all. Mm-hmm. I thought he was a little bit smaller than, you know, the pictures that I seen. He looked bigger and taller than what he was. So,
how about his demeanor in the courtroom? Was there anything that you took from him in person?
I didn't. You know, most of the time he was writing just as much as we were. So I think he was trying to pay attention and maybe write down questions or concerns that he had to pass along to Mr. Nelson.
Mm-hmm. What was your impression of him based off of what you saw in the videos and the testimony from the witnesses?
I felt that one picture that they took from the video that they just made a still frame of him with his hand in his pocket, that kind of got to me, like, this is my job, kind of don't tell me what to do type of thing. And he wasn't going to listen to what anybody had to say because he was in charge. So that kind of bothered me a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Could anything have changed your mind if you testified?
No. I don't think he should have testified. I think the prosecution would have chewed him up.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think they made a good choice.
A lot of people wonder about outside expectations and the impact that that might have had. You didn't get to deliberate, but do you think that outside forces would have played a role at all in your decision?
I don't. I feel like we took this trial very seriously. We didn't want anything to go wrong. I feel like none of us watched the news or were on our phones to social media or anything. We did not discuss it among any of us. So I wasn't aware until afterwards when I got released the magnitude of everything.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, I knew it was a high-profile case, obviously, but I didn't know all that stuff was going on.
Right.
So
there was another police shooting in your hometown during the trial.
Yes.
Did that play a role? Did it impact you at all?
It didn't impact me as far as this trial went. They were two separate trials. However, only being like 6 blocks away from the police department, I could hear everything. So when I came home, I could hear the helicopters flying over my house till like 1 a.m. I could hear the flashbangs going off. If I stepped outside, I could see the smoke from those smoke grenades going on. Mm-hmm. One day the trial ran a little bit late, so I had a hard time getting to my house because all the protesters were blocking the intersections and stuff. So I had to go way around just to get home.
Wow.
So, yeah. So I was aware, but it did not affect me at all.
Was it hard to avoid talking about this case or avoid seeing it on the news or conversations about it or newspapers or anything while you were serving on the jury?
I just pretty much came home, so it was just me and my roommate here. So we might have said a few things here and there, but not pertaining to the case.
Did you get to know the other jurors at all? Can you kind of talk about the collective experience?
I got to know them a little bit, but it was hard because, you know, we didn't talk about anything pertaining to the jury or to the trial at all, like anything, like any comments that day or what do you think about this or that. None of that was said. And then we didn't identify ourselves amongst each other, so we didn't say our names or our occupations or anything about our families. So we had to do small talk like, oh yeah, it's snowing out again today, or, you know, some little conversation, meaningless conversation. And it got kind of hard day after day because you run out of things to talk about. So, but they did let us have our phones.
Are you aware that later this summer the other three officers are scheduled to be on trial?
I heard that, yes.
Based on what you saw in this trial, how do you think that will go for them?
I think they're going to have a tougher time.
Convict them, you mean?
I'm sorry?
What do you mean by that, a tougher time?
Well, I think their trial, a lot of it's going to be impacted by this trial and the outcome of it. I just think everybody has a different role. They played such a different role, and everybody should be judged on their participation, I think.
Sure. So when you say tougher time, do you mean tougher time like putting on the trial because of the publicity and so forth that this one
had? Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
As far as like what you saw in the video from the other officers doing, mm-hmm. did it stand out to you that they played a role in George Floyd's death as well and might be liable criminally for it?
I think they played a lesser role. I don't know how much I should say my opinion on it.
Yeah, whatever you think.
I think Officer Lane brought to Chauvin's attention twice, asking, should we roll him over? So I thought that was important. And he also said, I think he's unconscious. So I think Officer Lane was really aware of what was going on and was generally concerned.
Mm-hmm. Why do you think he didn't do more to stop it?
I felt like because Chauvin was a senior officer, and I believe at one point their training officer, so I think it was kind of like a chain of command type of thing. Like, he's our senior officer, so we're just going to follow his lead.
Yeah.
Because I think they were pretty new, so, yeah.
If you could say anything now to the family of George Floyd, what would that be?
I would apologize to them, and I really felt their pain and their struggle. I have not personally been to 38th in Chicago. I think at some point I will, though, and I think that'll just be the final closure for me to pay my respects and let George Floyd know that we did the best that we could. So,
there was a family member in there every day. Did that was that impactful to you to see them there?
Yeah, I could see some of them crying at sometimes wiping their eyes and shaking their heads or, mm-hmm. yeah. So,
and if you could say anything to Derek Chauvin, what would that be?
I'm sad for him too. I wish it didn't have to happen. I think, I don't know how it goes from a $20 counterfeit bill to somebody dying. He should have just maybe wrote him a ticket and off he went. I mean, I think it got out of hand really quickly. So.
Do you mind grabbing your notebooks and just kind of showing us how many notes you took?
Sure.
So if you stand up, just make sure you grab that that packet so it doesn't dangle.
Okay.
Where are your notebooks? Over there?
They're on the table.
Yep. It's funny that you noticed the letters under Donald Williams' shirt. We were all noticing the same thing.
Well, I was sitting up there and I kind of saw, you know, some letters maybe. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so just sit back in your where you were before and then just kind of show us like how many notes you took here and stuff like that.
Okay. So they allowed us to take notes, and they gave us notebooks. So at the first day, the beginning of the day, they gave us these little ones, and we all were complaining about them, like, well, this isn't going to be enough. Mm-hmm. So there's very little notes in here. I wrote, like on this page, I wrote, you know, Monday the 29th at 2:20, and she was like the Speedway employee, and then I wrote down what she had to say.
How did that witness impact you?
It didn't. She didn't impact my decision either way.
She was kind of nervous, wasn't she,
yeah.
Or something?
Yeah, I felt kind of bad for her. So then they didn't want us writing on the first page, so they just had us put our jury number on the first page and then just start writing on the second page. Mm-hmm. And every time we left, they had us turn over all of our notebooks, and we could not take them out of court. We had to leave them there day after day. Mm-hmm. So, so I just wrote, like, on this day I would write Monday the 5th and 9:50. It was the state, and it was Dr. Bradford, or Langfelt.
Yeah.
Yep, I'm sorry. Just about, he pronounced him dead, when he was licensed and his background, his residency and stuff. Mm-hmm. And just that he didn't mention any drugs or overdose or didn't have a heart attack.
What was this experience like for you?
It was more intense than I thought it was going to be. I didn't think I would be as emotional as I was. Meaning when the bystanders, the first day that the bystanders came in, one of the 17-year-old girls was trying not to cry, and I could see her chin starting to quiver, holding back her tears, and then my eyes teared up. So,
what was it like seeing the 9-year-old on the stand?
I felt her sadness. She was, you know, pretty quiet and sad, and I felt like it affected her.
It sounds like even at night here, you took notes to kind of recap in your mind what you heard that day. So it was with you even at home here.
Yeah. Yeah. I just want to capture how I felt and how each person, if I felt they did made an impact, or if it didn't really matter what their testimony was. Mm-hmm. The people I was impressed with, little things I noticed about the witnesses and stuff.
Yeah.
So, yep, so these are the notes that I took from day one, like the time stamp and who they were, their backgrounds, and who was questioning them, whether it was the defense or the prosecutor, just so I could keep everything straight if I had questions.
So besides Darnella and Tobin, which witnesses really stood out to you and made you take a lot of notes?
I took a lot of notes when Mr. Williams was talking about the chokeholds and that type of stuff. He was important to me. Jenna Scurry was important to me. The 911 dispatcher, I was pretty impressed that from afar that she could even tell that, hey, something might be wrong. I really think the was he 19-year-old, the one that actually took...
The clerk?
The clerk, Christopher.
Yeah.
I could feel his guilt. I just felt like he feels responsible for the whole entire thing.